Hello, handsome devils and long-lost loves and all the ships at sea, and welcome to A Very Good Year, the movie podcast where we invite a guest to pick their favorite year of movies and talk to us about that year. I'm your host, Jason Bailey, and across the mic and across the country from me is my co-host,
Michael Hull.
And this is our December bonus episode. Welcome. Thank you for joining us. We have a little something special as a thank you for you, our loyal paid subscribers. And as with last month's bonus episode, we wanted to bring back one of our favorite guests from the first season. Luckily for us, and you don't get to do this much, we can update her intro this time around. You see, when she joined us back in September, she was senior correspondent at Vox. In November, the New York Times announced that she was joining the paper as movie critic. So please join us in welcoming back to the show our friend Alissa Wilkinson. Hi, Alissa.
Hello. It's good to be here.
Thank you so much for doing this. Congrats on the new damn gig, which is extremely cool.
Thank you. I'm happy to be there and here at the same time. It's fun. Space-time continuum kind of thing.
Yeah. So how's it going so far? Like, how has the adjustment been? How has the turnaround been? How is the culture over there thus far, et cetera, et cetera? Tell us about it.
Honestly, it's been pretty fun. I shouldn't say I didn't know what to expect, because of course I kind of did. I knew a lot of people there.
Sure.
I had a lengthy interview process, so I was pretty clear on what was going to happen. Once I got there, and I, like all of us, have read the New York Times movie criticism for a long time, but I didn't quite know, every time you like move jobs, you have new processes and you have new like quirks of an editor that you have to work around, or quirks of the paper.
Oh, yeah.
And there are probably a bit more of those.
Ooh.
Which you are familiar with, I think, just finding mm-hmm. out, for instance, that the preferred title is movie critic and not film critic was kind of a funny thing to discover. I can kind of see it.
The house style, like, I have been freelancing for that publication for Jesus Christ, since like 2017.
A long time.
And
yeah.
I still cannot get used to some of the quirks of the house style. Like,
no.
I still have to remind myself, it's not, director Martin Scorsese. It's the director Martin Scorsese.
The director. That was one of the first ones I learned. Or I submitted something with the term, I think I called something enormous, and was told mm-hmm. that enormous is generally used for physical objects. So I've been using my thesaurus a lot. I had in my probably my first week.
They passive aggressive that generally, like when you get
yes.
those notes, generally the, which like I've learned to read as, a dummy wouldn't do this. So yeah.
Well, yeah. Everyone has been enormously supportive. Mm-hmm. It's been really fun, and I have really enjoyed it, and I'm not just saying that. I think it's gone much more. It is. I have also like had to move suddenly in the last month, so I started the job and moved in the same month.
Wonderful timing.
New York is just hell,
Yep.
But I will say that starting the job is by
Alissa,
far the easier part.
No, I was going to say, at least it happened during the time of the calendar year that is most relaxed and chill for people who do our jobs.
That's right. Yes.
It's
I mean,
great.
At this point,
perfect
I'm just
timing.
Really glad that I don't also have, like, children, or last year I would have been also grading finals, and I no longer teach, so I'm not dealing with that. So on the whole, it's been great, and I have a desk, and it looks out on Port Authority, which we all know is the most beautiful place in New York City.
That
go wrong?
there's always a little mise-en-scene happening in front of Port Authority, so
yes,
it's appropriate.
Yes. Yes.
Man, the sausage, finding out how the New York Times sausage is made is such a wild experience, because like, as you described it as Tony, like that's well said, right?
Yeah.
And like finding, like meeting the people who really work there, and you're like, wait a minute, like you make sausage, bro. Like you're not.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
At some point you just realize that like everything in the entire world is just like made by people who are figuring it out. So that's, that's everything. So.
Figuring it out, just
making it up as you go along.
Yep, and fake it till you make it, and all mm-hmm. all of those helpful sayings. Okay. We yes. invited you on because we wanted to do an end of the year show talking about the movies of 2023. As is our want, just doing it much quicker than we usually do. And we wanted to strip it down a bit because we all know the headlines for 2023. And the final box office and awards are not yet in. And as we've seen on the show, it can be hard to get like a full grasp of a movie year until some time has passed. But
yeah,
my sort of starter question before we get into the segments, the regular segments, is in the moment, what are your thoughts on sort of the overall quality of film this year and where the art is at right now?
Yeah, I mean, I think most people, critics, kind of agree it was a pretty good year. you know, even if you didn't like all the films, there were so many movies worth talking about, which for me is totally. The measure of, I mean, as we're talking, The Zone of Interest is about to hit theaters, which is going to be an interesting time. Mm-hmm. And, you know, one thing, I really like that movie, but one thing that's interesting about it is that there's so much to talk about and there's so many different kind of viewpoints. And it felt like we had those movies starting pretty early and continuing on. And then on top of it, we had like actual good movies making a lot of money and people like going to the movies. I've kind of been telling people that I think what happened is Barbie and Oppenheimer, you know, really kind of started life as an internet meme. Like, how funny is this idea that people would go on the same day? But then people did, or maybe they didn't, but they went to both. And then they remembered that movies are like great. They're, you know, even when they're very long, they're just like a few hours. You know, you probably have like a comfy seat. Maybe you like get a beer or like bring your kid or whatever. And you sit there for a few hours. It costs you less than doing virtually anything else that you can do outside of your home, especially in New York, but pretty much anywhere else. And I think that translated into people actually being interested in movies again, which was really exciting to see. I felt encouraged for the first time in ages. And that was all happening in the middle of the strikes, which were sort of somewhere between incredibly discouraging and actually kind of heartening to watch happen. So, yeah, it's been an interesting year. There's that line, the kind of Irish curse that's may you live in interesting times. But I mean it in a positive way. It's been fascinating to watch, and it's felt like another shift that needed to happen in order for movies to survive at all.
You know, at least, thank goodness, now that people are interested in going to the movies again, the studios didn't dig in their heels for no good reason for several months and stop the production of new product.
I mean,
that would be a catastrophe. That would smell real.
On the flip side, though, there was too much stuff. So maybe
there was.
Maybe it'll be good.
Maybe we'll finally catch up.
Yeah. You know, people, I think, haven't been watching movies in part because there's like too many and you just shut down. Right. And I do. And I'm supposed to see a lot of them. I don't know. I there's a lot of economic repercussions and people's careers are at stake, and I know all of that, but I do think for the art form, a little less of it would probably be better in the end.
Right. Well, and you get into some of this really articulately in the year end best of that you and Manola co-wrote. Which we will link to obviously on the page, and we're going to talk about several of the movies that you run down on that, because it does have a top 10 from which we pulled your top five. And you guys intersected on a few points as well. But there was actually something that Manola said that caught Mike's eye when he was reading this to prep for the show. What was that, Mike?
Just the top paragraph, because we're always on the show whinging about how there's no mid-budget movies, there's nothing made for grown-ups, you know, there's always these sort of, all that exists is tent poles or things made on iPhones. And Manola's opening paragraph said, I had a terrific movie year. I saw hundreds of new films with a variety of plots and styles made on every imaginable scale and budget. That's just like one sentence. Some are from newcomers like A.B. Rockwell and others from the ever new Martin Scorsese, which is an amazing way to describe him. Mm-hmm. Some you've heard of or will, others scarcely make, while others scarcely made a ripple. Some are released by independents like A24 and the Tiny Kim Stim. Others came from tech companies and still others from what are now often called legacy studios. I mean, I just found that to be like, I had to read that paragraph several times to really sort of like get it into my head, because it's so opposite of the way we have talked about movies over and over and over over the past year. But the more I read it, the more I sort of reflected on the movies that I saw. Mm-hmm. And like, watching movies isn't my job. I always feel like I have to put a bit of a disclaimer when I'm talking about year-end wrap-ups with people whose job it is to watch hundreds of movies. But that my experience is reflected in that paragraph also. So mm-hmm. like, why is it that it doesn't seem like we've gotten that message, even though we're having that experience?
I mean, I will answer as a guy as the guy who keeps saying not that, which is that I'm not going to like sit up here and be like, but Nola's wrong. She's not wrong. I think often what I am talking about and frustrated by is a feeling that has existed for a while that I would like to think might be evolving. I don't want to say ending, but at least changing. Of it just felt like the only movies that were in the culture in an active way, the only things that people were talking about were either giant tentpole $200 million movies or tiny, you know, micro budget things that were impressive because they broke through or got made at all. But I think that we really have seen in the last year a shifting of that paradigm, at least to some extent, in that the sure things that used to be the only things that the legacy studios were willing to take chances on failed.
Yes.
You know, Oppenheimer was not supposed to be one of the biggest movies of the year. It was certainly not supposed to several times over outgross a new Indiana Jones movie. Mm-hmm. Flash movie with like multiple Batman in it. Like there were a lot of sure things this year that fucking tanked.
Yep.
And you know, a Marvel movie is not a sure thing anymore. Mm-hmm. So I would like to think that, you know, that is, you know, and I don't know what the chicken or the egg is in this scenario, that but that as a result of that, we are talking more about my sacred mid-budget movie. I don't know, Alissa, where do you land on that, on what Manola's saying there, and sort of how it plays into the contemporary cinematic narrative?
Yeah, I mean, it was a funny year because the biggest movie of the year being Barbie, obviously it looks and feels like a very expensive movie, but it has the sensibility of a less expensive movie, I would say.
It's very weird.
It's a deeply weird movie.
It feels handmade in a way that IP movies don't.
Yeah, and it kind of is. It has like practical effects. It has jokes about Italian fascists, and it's just a very strange movie, right? But I just, while you were talking, looked up the budget for two movies that are in my head right now, which are May December, Todd Haynes's film, which is a Netflix movie, but, you know, produced by Killer Films, as all of his films are. The budget on that is estimated around $20 million. I'm going to guess most of that went to the actors because it's, you know, kind of shot in mostly in a house. And then the Zone of Interest budget is estimated around $15 million, which seems maybe a little low, but it's clearly not a high-budget movie. As Zone of Interest is an A24 movie, but it played at Cannes. It won prizes there. May, December also played Cannes. And, you know, those are pretty mid-budgety movies. I think what you're talking about, because I feel it too, is that studios don't tend to take chances on mid-budget movies still. Right. And when they do, they've tried this kind of rom-com thing in the past couple years. And like, there was that really dismal George and Julia Go to Bali thing from, was that last year? Like, what a terrible movie that was. But it's, you know, it's because even when they're well, I don't know what that cost. It probably was kind of expensive. But even when they're doing that kind of like smaller movie for ostensibly grownups, they're so risk averse that you still end up often with a movie that just, you know, there was the Meg Ryan, David Duchovny one. I don't know anyone who saw it. Did it come out? I guess it came out.
It did.
Maybe it did. You know, there's that kind of movie where there's like some element that used to exist is missing. And I think, you know, not again to talk about the strikes too much, but I think a result of the strikes and all the studios being like, wah, wah, well, we can't invest the way we used to, is like, maybe, okay, well, maybe he'll actually do something interesting. You know, if Greta can do what she did with Barbie, why not give that money to somebody else or give split that money five ways and make five movies? You know, so there's a lot of kind of shifts in the industry, and the business has not caught up with itself and did sort of too much. And now they're contracting it, and like TV doesn't pay off the way it used to. So I think we're just in a huge flux state, which is what excites me. You know, it's funny, my predecessor, I'm not a chief film critic, but the reason I have my job is because A.O. Scott moved over to the book review and a job opened up. And when he's great. He's an incredible critic, great person, and had done the job for a long time. And when he left, he like gave a couple interviews where he was like, I'm just kind of not hugely excited about where the business is going. And I agree with him. But this year felt like it actually kind of turned that back on itself a little bit and said, like, maybe the business is in one of those inflection points that we've seen before, like we saw in the 50s, and then the 60s happened, and who knows what we're going to see. We're in a very different culture than it was in the 60s, but there's space and there's interest. And, you know, one of the best movies of the year, according to me, or several of the best movies of the year were Sundance movies, and Sundance is often lower to mid-budget movies. So there's a lot, there's a lot out there that's happening right now.
Well said. Shit. Look at us. State of the industry, man.
Yep.
All right. Alissa Wilkinson, you ready to do a top five?
I am.
All right. So, so again, you can, we will link this. You can read, more on this. But we are taking the top five from Alissa's New York Times top 10. Which is a wonderful and varied list. And I agree with almost all of it. So what then is the number five movie for this year, 2023?
At number five, I had A Still Small Voice, which is a documentary by Luke Lorenzen.
There's an old adage, don't just stand there, do something. And we flip that. We say, don't just do something. Stand there or be there. Because there's connection and healing in that.
And I would imagine will probably be the one that the casual moviegoer is least likely to know about. So we don't need to do this on all, but sort of what is this movie exactly for someone who hasn't heard of it?
It was the first great movie I saw this year. I saw it before Sundance. I went to Walter Reed Theater at Lincoln Center, which we know and love, and it was me and one friend of ours, and I sat all the way in the back, he sat all the way in the front. And
Ideal.
And it's so Luke is a really talented and interesting documentarian. His last film was Midnight Family, which is this really fascinating observational doc about a family that runs a ambulance company in Mexico City, where most of the ambulances are run by for-profit companies. And it was very much about like, how do they deal with kind of the pressure of the job, the business of the job, the like structure of the medical system, and the kind of people you encounter when you drive an ambulance all night. So A Still Small Voice feels like a very natural progression from there.
Totally.
He went to Mount Sinai Hospital. It's shot in early enough pandemic that it was at a time when people couldn't go to the hospital to be with their loved ones who were like dying or experiencing tragic conditions or whatever. And Mount Sinai is a big hospital. There's a group of chaplain residents there who were there in a one-year program, kind of, you know, they're trained, but they're getting their hands-on experience. And Luke basically was a one-man band while he was there, right, because he couldn't have a crew. And he follows all of them, but in particular, a resident named Mati, who kind of comes from like a sort of Jewish background, but she's kind of more spiritual, perhaps, than religious. And part of the job, it's an ecumenical job. So part of the job is kind of administering spiritual care to people from various traditions or like no traditions at all. While, you know, helping them through things as varied as like a terminal illness or a miscarriage or, you know, numerous other kinds of really difficult things that you run into in a hospital. But then also we see her and some of the other residents having their meetings, grappling with what they're going through. Also, she kind of runs into conflict with her supervisor, who is also chaplain. You know, everyone's under kind of, it's a very stressful situation to be in, but it's like, yeah, much more stressful given the circumstances. And it's a really beautiful film. It sounds like it'd be super depressing, but it's a really beautiful film about how do people minister to one another, mm-hmm, you know, in that kind of a situation. And what does that do to yourself? What does that do to your soul? You know, how do you deal with that kind of stress? And, you know, I won't give away how it ends, but I think it's, you know, it doesn't leave you with like some kind of cheerful, like, yay, humanity feeling exactly, but it's very much a movie about struggling. And I think it's one of the great, it doesn't really present as a pandemic movie, but I think it's one of the great pandemic movies that we're going to get. But also just kind of a lovely film about some of the most difficult things that a human can go through and how we help one another through that. So it's in theaters, like in New York and LA, but it'll eventually be, you know, digitally available and most people will see it that way. But I think if you can kind of psych yourself up for it, it's a really beautiful experience.
Yeah. Yeah. I watched it a couple of weeks ago on your recommendation before this list was published, just as we were sort of hashing out, you know, when you do this job and you get to the end of the year and you realize there are like literally 3-4 dozen movies that everyone says you should see before the year is out. And before you're, mm-hmm, doing voting and lists and things, you have to sort of huddle up together with people you trust. What I found astonishing about this movie is, you know, I feel like there's just a quality that the great documentarians just have to have of embedding long enough and modestly enough that the subject does like forget that they are there.
Yeah, completely.
And sometimes even in good documentaries, you don't get that sense. But I feel like, mm-hmm, in great documentaries, you almost always do.
Very much.
Unless it's like an Errol Morris who's doing like,
right, you know, supposed to be
baroquely stylized things, you know.
Yes.
So what I found, you know, the people are so compelling. The subjects that he, the subject matter and the people that he focuses on are so so fascinating. But there were scenes by the end where I couldn't imagine forgetting that a camera was there while I was saying things that are that hurtful or potentially alienating or vulnerable, you know?
Yes. Yes.
It's very powerful.
It is very, and I, you know, I did a Q&A right before I started this job with Luke and Mati on opening weekend. And I knew a lot about the film just from hearing them talk about it all year, but Mati said something I didn't know, which is that they got permission from all the patients that they spend time with. Mm-hmm. But then after they shot the film, they went back and showed them the footage and said, do you consent? Like, do you want this in the film, basically? So,
oh, wow.
which makes it, I think, even more powerful. I kind of wish I had known that watching it, because, you know, that's something you worry about. And I kind of assume there's a certain amount of documentary ethics that go into the making of a movie like that. But these are people who are literally experiencing some of the hardest things they'll ever, ever go through. There's one scene that I just think about, honestly, all the time, with a couple who've like had twins and one of them has died. And Monty, she's in the, someone says, you have to go take care of them. And she's like, how do I perform a baptism? Like, I don't know what it is, you know? And she shows up and she does what she needs to do. And it's just like completely heartbreaking and beautiful. And so I think, like, degree of difficulty alone, this film deserves a lot of accolades, but also the thoughtfulness that they approached matters of consent and vulnerability and things like that are really moving, you know, as kind of a collaborative film more than anything else.
The amount of trust that you have to engender as a documentary director to come back and say, look at this. Wasn't that fucking terrible? I mean, like, the amount of trust that you already had worked into the relationship before that point is the only way you can even start to have that conversation. That's really good. That's amazing. That's amazing. That's Wow. Yeah.
And, great, you know, a lot of documentarians, this is obviously a huge conversation in the documentary world, but a lot of them, you know, there's a feeling like, well, if we let the subjects have final cut, essentially, we won't have a truthful film. And I think this one really stands as testament that you can. It's just, it's all about relationships. So I love it for a lot of reasons.
Yes. Documentary ethics are a thing I can talk about.
But I used to
they have
teach
a bottomless interest in.
I used to teach documentary to undergrads, and not making them, just watching them. And you know, there's so many aspects of it that they never think about. And I would absolutely be assigning this film if I were still doing that. So
God, that's going to be a weird adjustment for you, not teaching anymore and figuring out how you're going to teach things.
I know. I keep mentally rewriting my syllabi, but anyhow.
All right, Alissa, what then is the number four movie on your top 10 for 2023?
Yeah, my number four is this film, Reality.
Look, you've had a good career. I don't think you're a big, bad master spy. I think you just messed up. I think you might have been angry about what's going on.
The Russians attacked our democracy.
Before the election took
place, the president's campaign may have participated in it.
They didn't attack.
Reality. Were you surprised to see us today?
Which has, I think, possibly the best title of any movie on the list. So it's a movie about Reality Winner, who is the whistleblower who went to prison. She was a contractor and for the NSA. She was a translator, and she came across information that led her to believe that there was Russian interference in the election. And she leaked the documents to The Intercept, and the FBI showed up at her door, and she, until very recently, was in prison. So this started life as the transcript of the interrogation from the FBI, because they had recordings of it. And then that recording, among other things, was taken by Tina Satter, who's a playwright and a director, a dramaturg in New York, turned into an off-Broadway show called Is This a Room, that I saw right before the pandemic off-Broadway. And it is a direct transcript. The actors, that's the lines they speak. And there's actors playing Reality and also the Reality Winner, the woman, and then also the FBI agents. And there's like a couple other characters who show up. And it's just that. There's no commentary. The only thing that happens that isn't a direct transcript is when there's redacted bits of the transcript. On stage, there was kind of a loud noise and the lights went out. And then the play transferred to Broadway right after the pandemic, where I saw it was just as good. And then I found out they were making a film of it. That's what this is. So when you watch it, you have to know it is a very formally odd film, and it's really useful to know what it is going in. But Sydney Sweeney plays Reality Winner. the name changed to Reality, and of course that's literally her name, but also it's a film about what is reality and you know, when are you kind of being lied to by your government or some other force, and what counts as reality. And you know, the word gaslight gets thrown around a lot in our world, I think, but it is kind of about gaslighting and who's doing it, where it is, all those things. It has really good performances. But Sydney Sweeney is in particular amazing. She's, if you only think of her,
she's spectacular. She's amazing in this movie.
If you think of her as like the girl from Euphoria or the girl from The White Lotus, you're not wrong. She's very good at that kind of thing. And she's in that upcoming rom-com with Glenn Powell. But this is a tour de force performance. I don't use that lightly. She's doing something I don't even know how to put into words. So I just, you know, the film has really stuck with me as one of the few actually formally adventurous films that still, like, you watch it and you are like angry and also gut punched by the end. And it's real. That's really how it happened. That's another layer to that reality word. So it's on Max. It was at Berlin, I believe, and it did a little bit of traveling, and then HBO bought it and just put it on streaming. But you can see it there, and you should. And I wish more people would see it, because it really is a remarkable achievement, I think.
Yeah. I had sort of, as with so many movies that get bought by these services, I had been like, I should watch that. It's right there. And then, like, I don't get around to it. Like, fuck, Alissa, there are new Wes Anderson movies that I still haven't watched. They're right there.
Yeah, there sure They're are. Right there. Four of them.
They're right there. They're right fucking there. So this was right there. And so when we very quickly decided to do this episode and I looked at your list, this was the only one I hadn't seen. So I watched it last night and it is a fucking knockout. Like, and you couldn't be more right about how formally impressive it is that, you know, the choices, the very deliberate choices she's making in terms of composition, in terms of staging, obviously as a play director, like that's front of mind, but also cinematically, it's incredibly cinematic the way that she, and I don't even want to spoil it because the first time it happens, it's so through me, but the way that she does the redacted passages is so ingenious. Sydney Sweeney's incredible. Josh Hamilton, who I've always loved.
So great.
kicking and screaming forever. This is
from eighth grade.
this is 180 from anything he's ever done. But uses that baggage of the sort of warmth, cozy sweater of a guy, and then just absolutely turns it into a fucking shiv. It's really, really good. The top three on this list, you know, are ones that people have heard about in many forms, in many platforms as things to seek out at the end of the year. But reality, it's right there. You can just go watch it right now. And I strongly encourage you to do so. Okay. What then, as we now move into the top three that folks maybe have more likely heard of or seen, what is the number three movie on your list, Alissa Wilkinson?
So the number three is The Zone of Interest.
Im Osten steht unser Morgen. Vielen Dank für eure nationalsozialistische Gastfreundschaft.
I'm curious to see how many people will actually know what this film is at the end of the day, because it is kind of, you know, it's not a movie I would even necessarily say I like. Because it's hard to, I mean, it feels like deranged to say you like this movie. Mm-hmm. So it's Jonathan Glazer, who people know from Under the Skin. It's based on, very, very loosely based on, like, the first bit and the epilogue of a Martin Amis novel by the same name. It is also formally insane. I think it's fair to say. Mm-hmm. It is one of the most disturbing things I've ever seen in my whole life. I know I'm selling it really well.
I just read the description to my wife and she said, fuck that movie. And that was the end of the conversation. So
I'm pretty sure
I might have to watch it quietly in the office.
That's kind of exactly the response you're supposed to have, I think. Like, it's not you know, I didn't know, I kind of knew vaguely what it would be when I went in to see it at Cannes, but you kind of sit in the dark for like 2.5 minutes at the beginning where there's just this like horrible droning and a black screen, and then it starts. Yeah, he's not messing around. What I love about the movie, first of all, is in my last book, I wrote a lot about Hannah Arendt. Keep in mind, this came out I saw it in May. So this was before a lot of current events kind of made people talk even more about Arendt and all of this. But people have continually brought up the concept of banality of evil with reference to this movie. I think it understands that concept better than most critics do, because banality of evil is not about evil being boring or normal. Right. It's about, it's actually about bureaucratic language and the refusal to think. You know, for that, I would just refer people to my review at Vox, because I just reread it and I kind of feel like I'm written it in such a fugue state that I'm like, how did I do this on deadline at Cannes? but you know, it's essentially about a Nazi commandant at Auschwitz who runs the camp. It's been described as kind of Big Brother style filming of the inside of his house. The main character is kind of Sandra Hüller, who plays his wife. She's also the star of Anatomy of a Fall this year. She's one of the year's MVPs. She's incredible. Yeah. But we never see inside the camp, or maybe we do once, but it's what we see is their lovely, easy life. Their kind of their beautiful gardens and their nice house. It becomes a horror film because you're not seeing anything. Now, I've heard that Glazer actually shot scenes inside the walls, and then when they got to post, decided not to put those in. So that's like a really deliberate choice because, well, there's a whole battery of philosophical reasons that you would make that choice, I think. Like it or hate it, I don't think you can ignore it. I do think it's one of those movies that we'll still be talking about and arguing about in 50 years, which for me makes it probably a worthy addition to the list. But if you can stomach it, I think it's worth watching, if only to be able to talk about it wisely and smartly. But I do think the accomplishment is large there, and kind of the allusions he's making to Leni Riefenstahl and like all these kind of different things that are happening in that movie are horrifying. And I think the movie will grow in stature over time. We'll see if I'm right, but I think it's pretty remarkable.
Yeah, I agree. I almost said I liked it too, which is again like an insane way to discuss this movie.
Yeah.
I am not as taken with it as some of my fellow critics, just because there are a couple of formal choices he makes that I don't think work. But while simultaneously like wildly respecting the ambition of taking them. You know,
yes.
Of making them, of taking those chances. And you also like, you have to take big swings. There are other formal choices he makes, and I'm not giving anything there. The formal choices of the last like 10 minutes of this thing are just like unimpeachable. So yes, you know, it is an incredibly potent and worthwhile film and worth seeing and really worth talking about. And Mike, after you sneak into the office and watch it quietly, I look forward to having what I'm sure will be a very animated conversation about it. Let's pin that now for an upcoming bonus episode once the season starts up. Alissa, number two on the 2023 list.
A very different movie. Yeah. Past Lives.
What a good story this is. Childhood sweethearts who reconnect 20 years later and realize they were meant for each other. In the story, I would be the evil white American husband standing in the way of destiny.
Shut up.
He was just this kid in my head for such a long time. I think I just missed him.
Did he miss you?
His arm.
which I also saw at Sundance. And I remember, so I knew Celine Song's plays or some of them, but I knew also that she was in development on a feature. And when it popped up on the Sundance list, I was like, oh, cool. Like, gotta see it. And then walked in the theater and then walked out and was like, oh, wow, that was like possibly the best movie of the year. I mean, you know, I don't know, maybe something will top it.
In mid-January.
In mid-January, which is insane. I mean, you know, in some ways, it's exactly the movie we're talking about that we wish were more of them were made, right? It's like a small, basically kind of three-hander, I guess, you know, about a woman and the lives she didn't lead. But I think one thing I really love about this movie is that it totally doesn't go in the direction you think it's going to. It seems like, you know, Hollywood has kind of one way of telling love triangle stories, or like maybe two.
God, yes.
And this one barely qualifies as a love triangle, even though it really is. I was kind of arguing with someone months ago who saw it and was like, well, I just wanted it to be more romantic. And I was like, no, but this is how people's lives are. Like, this is just, this is real life. And the people in this movie, to me anyhow, and I recognize like it's about a writer who lives in Brooklyn. So, but to me, it's like, I know these people, like, you know, I these are how people I know talk. These are places I go. And she basically, you know, she grows up, she has kind of a childhood sweetheart in her youth in Korea. She emigrates to Canada and eventually to the United States. They kind of intermittently keep in touch, and eventually she marries another guy, and then they get back in touch, and her childhood sweetheart comes to visit in New York. And that's sort of
the plot. That's the movie.
You know? But there's a lot of pieces I love, and I knew I was going to love it from the very first moment, which is where some people are sitting across the bar from these people and they're speculating about what their story is. And I mean, the number of times I've done that is high.
I mean,
but yeah, it, I just,
yes, it's an incredibly relatable scene. It's a thing we've all done, but also like the meta level on which that scene is functioning.
Yes.
Like that scene is about the entire act of movie making in a really interesting way.
Yes, entirely. Mm. Yeah. And it felt really true to me. And I think I've only seen it once. I usually see stuff twice if I can. But I remember scenes from it as if they have, you know, as if I watched it yesterday, which just for me says something about the visual quality of it as well. It's just a beautiful movie, and the kind of movie that you could watch with, you know, pretty much anyone in your life and feel things in a good way. I wouldn't say it's a happy ending, but it's definitely a good ending.
No, it's a perfect
movie.
I there are movies I saw this year that people told me were, you know, take your hankies, you're gonna cry like a baby at the Iron Claw, and where I would you know, and I left like dry-eyed, because, you know,
cry at movies. I don't but
do.
I've seen you cry a lot at movies.
I am a pretty soft touch. I didn't cry at some of the stuff people told me I was going to cry at this year, but I sobbed in this movie. And realized in a really big way that was about, you know, this was the first thing I wrote about it in maybe a fucking tweet, because I was probably still on Twitter when I saw this at Sundance. But the first thought I had was that this movie reminds me of the Roger Ebert quote about the movies that make him cry are not about when tragic things happen to people. It's when people are good, when people are in spite of sort of what they may want. I don't know. It really got to me, because I think. Yeah. Whatever the specifics of this situation are, I think almost anyone who sees this film has had that question in their life of like, what would have happened if this, it addresses that in a really direct and poignant and affecting way. And also, they're just all so good. Like,
they're so good.
John McGarrow is incredible. Greta Lee. I have wanted Greta Lee to be a star for like 5 years now. I couldn't be happier that she's in this movie, and I hope that she gets the recognition she deserves.
There's a good piece that ran in the paper that Kyle Buchanan wrote this week, I think, with John McGarro and Teo Yu. And apparently in the pandemic, John had just gotten married and was like setting up house and, you know, just kind of being a Brooklyn guy. And Teo Yu is a soap star in Korea. And for whatever reason, was on some kind of a reality show where he had to like be on an island with like rich people and serve them food and stuff at this. So they had like worlds apart experiences, which I think all kind of you pick up in the film. Like these are two lovely guys who are just like not polar opposites, not living in the same universe. It's pretty great.
Okay, well then that brings us to the top, and boy, a movie would really have to be something special to be better than Past Lives, to be better than the movie we both pinned as the best movie of the year in mid-January. So what is your and I would add mine, and I would add Manola's pick for the best movie of 2023.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I felt like it was almost expected, and I tried to get around it, and then I was like, no, there's no getting around this. Killers of the Flower Moon is so good. Yeah, it's so good.
You know, you got nice color skin. What color would you say that is?
My color.
The Osage, they have the worst land possible, but they outsmarted everybody.
The land had oil on it,
black gold. Money flows freely here now.
I do love that money, sir.
I mean, it's, you know, it's Marty. We love Marty. But also, whatever he's doing here is just, he keeps getting better. I don't, like, what's he taken? I don't know. I will say what I love most about Killers of the Flower Moon is, I also saw this at Cannes, had no idea what it was going to be, except that I had read the book. So I knew what the story was, David Graham's book. And David Graham's book is basically about the FBI and how they investigated this, like, horrifying string of murders, crash of murders. I was bowled over when I watched the movie because it's very straightforward and almost like not plotting isn't the right word, but it's very like one foot in front of the other when you're watching it. It doesn't tell the story like the book does, which is a little more of a whodunit. You know whodunit from the start,
right away,
pretty much. Leo is playing a very different kind of character than often he does. The whole time I was like, what are you doing, Marty? Cause I know he likes to mess with you a little bit in ways that you're not expecting. And I had the Irishman in my head, and the ending of the Irishman is like the most devastating thing I've probably ever seen in my life. And I got to the end, and I won't give it away, but the scene happens, and suddenly I was like, oh my God, I have to go back and watch the whole movie over again. And when I actually did, the whole thing clicked into place. What's he doing with this movie? And, you know, it's, I wrote a piece for Vox right before I left about how this fits in with his last two films, which are The Irishman and Silence. And they all kind of work together as a confessional piece with him thinking about his life and also the act of storytelling and how it works and how the person telling the story can shape the story in ways that warp reality. And there's a real element of that to this movie. And the end is so brilliant that I kind of left the theater and I was just like, how did that happen? Mm-hmm. How did he do that? And in a sense, this is a movie he could only make at this point in his career. And, you know,
100%.
Most people could never make this movie and have that scene make sense. Yeah, and there's a lot of other amazing things about it. Obviously, Lily Gladstone needs to win an Oscar for her role in this. She's just phenomenal. But I didn't stop thinking about it, you know, for 6 months. So that made it obvious that this was the best movie of the year. And I would say this is the other movie from this year that I have Oppenheimer on my list. I have other movies on my list, but this is the one that I think will really, really endure. And hopefully it's not his last film, but if it was for some reason, it would be a very worthy one. Although we've been saying that for like five movies now, so we'll see.
I know. You know, and
you've been right the whole time.
Yeah. I mean, you know, it doesn't feel quite like a guy literally picking out his own coffin the way that The Irishman did.
Yeah.
But that last scene in particular and the casting choices that are made within it, it's a thesis statement. This is the other movie that made me cry this year, and I wept in the scene before that the first time I saw it. And then that sort of carried through. The second time, when the final actor appears, I burst into tears because it was all so clear. It's all so, we're talking in such coded language and but when you see the thing, you'll know. But in general, the general thought, I can't put it any more simply than this. No one's working at the level he's working at. No one who is currently making movies in the world is working at the level of skill and craftsmanship and expertise and brilliance that he is.
Yep.
And there have only been a handful of people in the history of the fucking medium who have been working at this level. And they were all doing it this late in their lives. I don't think anyone can touch him right now.
No, and you know, there's been quite a few late career movies this year that are like that. The Miyazaki is a great example also, and the Weissman film, he's like 1,000 years old has made like 1 billion movies. But these are all, you know, they're all like old guys, but they're all really thinking about stuff, and it's really coming out in their movies, and we're just lucky to be around for it, I think.
Yeah. I cannot think of a better note to close that top five on than that. This is a great list, Alissa. Go read and read the other five also, and what Alissa has to say about all of them. Or let's enjoy a lightning round. All right, we're going to put 5 minutes on the clock. Alissa, say something quick, because we got a lot of good ones here. And here we go. The aforementioned Oppenheimer.
Incredible. A movie about power. It's great. Kudos to Noah.
Barbie.
I enjoyed Barbie. I think it kind of, it's best if you read it as an Adam and Eve story. So that's where I left it.
Poor Things.
I also enjoyed Poor Things. I don't think it has a lot going on upstairs, but it's the nicest movie Yorgos Lanthimos has ever made. And Mark Ruffalo, how can you not? Like, best himbo in history.
Magnificent. American Fiction.
I laughed my butt off during that movie. I need to go back and rewatch it now that I know that it's funny and just like see if I still like it, but I did have a good time.
Wonka.
I haven't seen it yet. They never invited me to a screening.
The Color Purple.
I have just reviewed it. So you can read my review in the New York Times when the embargo breaks. But I will say Danielle Brooks is spectacular in it. So give her an Oscar.
A Fire.
Oh, I really liked A Fire, and not just because it's about a grumpy writer. I think it's like really, really interesting the way it's constructed, the way it ends, the whole thing. It stuck with me.
Godland.
Well, that's one of my favorites this year. And I think that if you want to see like a priest get his butt kicked by Iceland and like what's the guy's name? Ragnar or something with the big beard. Oh, it's a blast.
The Eternal Memory.
Another incredible documentary from this year. I've seen it a couple times, and I think, you know, part of it is just these people live in a house surrounded by books, but also any documentary about memory is going to really kick me in the gut. So very much recommend.
Smoke Sauna Sisterhood.
Yeah, I can't believe this one. It felt like it almost didn't happen. It's an incredible documentary. To my mind, it's the best kind of feminist movie of the year, but people should be aware that it's almost entirely nude women shot from the neck down in a sauna. So don't like watch it on the subway, I guess is what I'm trying to say. I know you would never.
I would never. Saltburn.
No. Okay, I'm in the minority here. I really like. I really like this movie, and I think it's dumb, but I think it's dumb on purpose. So, if you're really into like Patricia Highsmith crossed with Bride's Head Revisited crossed with like a needle straight in your eye, I don't know. I think it's worth the shot.
See, there was a little lag, and right after I said Saltburn, you were still saying no, and I thought that was gonna be, which I agree with.
Nope.
You Hurt My Feelings.
Oh, so funny. I took my husband to see You Hurt My Feelings, which should be tell you how much I liked it, because it is a movie that we very specifically should have feelings about. But we enjoyed it.
The Starling Girl.
I am very much primed to love this movie. It's basically about me growing up. But it flew under the radar, I think, because it's so small, and I would love for people to seek it out. It's sort of coming of age mixed with religious trauma. Great performances. Highly recommend.
Great combo. Speaking of religious trauma, Sound of Freedom. Did you see Sound of Freedom, Alissa?
I did not. That's the end of the statement.
No.
Ari Aster's Bo is Afraid.
I seem to be deeply in the tank for Ari, but I think that's because every time he makes a movie, there's like, you could write like 7 different pieces about it. And I think I only wrote 2 about Bo is Afraid. But Patti LuPone, A+, GOAT, best ever.
Sofia Coppola's Priscilla.
I love this movie a lot. And not only because Jacob Elordi is about 3 feet taller than Kaylee Spinney. It's smart. It's very Sophia, but it's a very smart movie. And it's a very smart movie.
Ridley Scott's Napoleon.
Great movie.
What an insane film. I mean, I think I love it all the more because the French hate it. It's so funny. You think you're so special because you have boats? Like, come on.
And finally, Are You There, God? It's Me, Margaret.
Do you know, it took me forever to see this movie because I kept like missing screenings and like being out of town. And I finally watched it on a plane to Argentina about a month ago. And I was like, this is an insanely charming movie. Rachel McAdams is amazing. Benny Safdie, who's having like the time of his life this year. Yeah, everyone should watch that movie. It's wonderful. It's wonderful. Mm-hmm.
It is wonderful.
Good year for movies.
Good year for movies. Very good lightning round. Now we're going to throw it to our friend W. Axel Foley for a quick PSA.
Head on over to your favorite podcasting app. Give us a star, a rate, a review. Give us a written review and tell us that you love us, because that's what lets people know that we're here.
Alissa, where can people find you these days on social media?
I pretty much only post to social media when I have something come out or when my brain is full. But I'm still on whatever we call it now, Twitter, X, whatever. But now I have to post to everything else. So you can find me on Twitter, X, Instagram, Blue Sky, Threads, like Substack Notes, LinkedIn, like pretty much anywhere. And on all of them, I'm just Alissa Wilkinson, except on Twitter/X, where I've been for like 20 years now. It's Alissa Marie.
There we go. I am Fun City Cinema on Instagram, Jason-Bailey on Blue Sky and Letterboxd, where you can find under my list the top fives for every episode of the show. Mike, where can people find you?
Nowhere. I'm just going to start posting my address. I can't stand social media.
Sounds good. And of course, we are on Substack, a very good year.substack.com, which may be where you're listening to this right now. Mike, before we go, what is your favorite movie of 2023?
I had problems this year, man. I'm not ready to wrap this up yet. I still need some therapy around this year, because I figured it out at Thanksgiving, because my sister wanted to host Thanksgiving for some reason. But when someone wants to, you let them. And I was put on pie duty. And so no problem, I can make the pies. So I had a request for apple hand pies, for pecan, and for a gluten-free pecan, and for a pumpkin. And I was like, no problem, I can knock all that shit out. And I did those pies. And then I was like, I don't want to eat any of those. And I made a cherry bourbon, like with, you know, proper frozen cherries. And then I made blueberry cognac pie, right? That were both just like... And a little bit of like winter spice in the blueberry pie. Like, they turned out wonderfully, right? And as I was eating my blueberry cognac pie very happily, I realized that this is a proper analogy for me watching movies this year. I was not here for comfort food, right? Like, I did not. I watched The Holdovers. I did not enjoy it. Does that mean I don't like a movie where Paul Giamatti's cranky and then tries not to be? That's insane. Of course. I love those movies. How could I not like those movies? Right? I didn't like Asteroid City. I really liked The Alien. I have to interrupt to say I really did enjoy The Alien. But, like, does that mean... Of course not. His movies are fucking great. I just wasn't here for him this year. The one that made me sad, though, was The Pigeon Tunnel. Like, you're watching The Pigeon Tunnel, and you're like, okay, this is great, right? And then you're like, all right, cut to the load fucking Dutch. You know, cut to the fucking, like, unnecessarily close side shot. Cut to the pigeon tunnel, back to the front. No, you couldn't predict the edits at some point in that movie. And then this is, you know, this is one of my favorites. And I also love Le Carre novels. So, like, I just wanted something. I needed some experimentation. Like, is he not bored with that?
Clearly not.
All right. So I need to have this conversation. I know you're going to hate me saying this, Jason. You hate me saying all of these things. I can see the look on your face. But am I wrong? Like, were these people bringing new things to the table this year? Was it just me that needed new things?
No, it's not. But you know what? I liked all of those movies more than you did. None of them are in my top 10. None of them are in my top 5.
Fair enough.
You know, the movies that Alissa and I agree on, and you know, the one that I'll talk about when you ask me what my one is, are in fact taking risks, taking chances, doing new things. But I also like comfort food. Like, I know what Errol's going to give me now. I'm not asking one of the greatest documentarians of all time to reinvent the wheel at age 70, whatever he is. Like,
did, like, several times. He has the ability. He has that shit in him. That's what makes him so great.
I'm fine with watching a standard Errol Morris documentary. I'm happy to have it.
Well, I'm also not like whinging because Wiseman didn't like hire a fucking voiceover artist to lace the whole thing, right? Not complaining about that. So that's what I mean. This shit is on me. It's on me. Like, I'm not trying to say like Wes Anderson made a shitty movie. Like, clearly this is about my taste this year, you know?
Yeah.
But,
and own that. And that's great. I'll slide you some recs that might shake your core a little bit.
Well, I'm going to tell you, I haven't watched Killers of the Flower Moon yet because I'm afraid of bringing this shitty attitude into this movie. And like,
Mike,
you know,
I can tell you, I'm never bold enough to presume what you will like or not like, but I will tell you that I don't think you will find Killers of the Flower Moon to be comfort food. That's all I'm saying.
No.
I think that is a fair prediction.
Yes. All right. So my favorite movie this year. Thank you for indulging me in this conversation. Yeah. But I think my favorite movie this year, it makes it obvious, was El Conde. Did either of you
see
El Conde?
Hell yes. El Conde's fucking great.
Oh my God. I loved that movie so much. And it was like, you know, it's one of those things where you know they're going to recount some of the, you know, some of the stats. You know they're going to give you some of the facts and figures on why this guy sucked so bad. You know, right. But the way that they introduce this sort of fiduciary character that then he thinks he's going to try to, like, fuck, I guess. I don't know. You're 300 years old. Like, it just sort of the way all of that stuff got figured into the movie.
Yep.
I just thought was incredibly creative, was super smart. And then when they reveal who the narrator was.
Yes.
Because, like, I wasn't really that concerned with who the narrator was. It was just some lady and she's telling the story, you know?
Yes.
So then when they actually take the step to introduce the narrator, and it is who it is, and it figures into not just like the plot and the character of the movie, but that puzzle piece snaps into real history in a way that is just like, all right, that's top shelf shit. You know, that right there is sort of that extra layer that you didn't need to make this movie good, but you did it anyway because you two were bored with movies. Thank you so much, dude. Yeah, anyway, I fucking love, I was continually surprised and delighted by El Conde. I don't know if I've ever picked a vampire movie as my favorite movie of any year, but 2023, that's the one. How about you?
As I said, my number one and number two are the exact same as my good friend Alissa. So I'm going to, at this point, instead of rehashing my previous points, I'm going to tell you my number three of the year, which is Eileen, which I also saw at Sundance. I didn't stop thinking about it for the entire year, and I had to just keep thinking about it the entire year because it just fucking came out. But it's a wonderfully lurid, pulpy, freakish. From what I understand, the book is considerably more freakish, but it's just the best kind of, like, well-worn pulpy paperback novel of a movie. And every weird fucking place that thing went, I was ready to follow. I was ready to follow that movie into the bowels of hell. And I run hot and cold on Thomas and McKinsey. She's fantastic. She has a moment of just looking out a window and thinking that is some of the best screen acting I've seen all year. And Hathaway, I'm not sure if this is been deemed cultural appropriation to use this phrase, but I'm going to say it anyway. Anne Hathaway understood the assignment. She understood the fucking assignment. Eileen is fantastic. It's in theaters now. It's a neon release, so it'll be digital soon. It'll eventually be on Hulu like next year. Seek it out. It's really, really terrific. Alissa, thank you again for doing this.
Yes.
Thank you.
I not to get too emotional, I'll make it quick, but I was thinking earlier tonight, just holy shit, next year, Sundance, January of 2023 is a decade that we've been friends.
That's true. We hung out there, but...
Neither will I.
So that's fine. We'll just get a beer here instead.
Yes. The first time Alissa and I hung out was at Sundance in 2013.
That is true.
Both of us were really just kind of starting in this thing. And it's been an eventful decade for both of us, and I value your friendship, and I value your writing, and I feel very lucky to know you, and I'll stop there. Thank you again for coming on.
Yeah, thank you. It's always a pleasure.
Thank you, Mike.
Truly.
Thank you, Jason.
And thank you for listening.